Hello and welcome to Simply inTAXicating. The GST today stands at a very sensitive point of time. Many serious challenges appear to be staring directly in the eyes of the government. Some of them are policy issues, legislative issues, and procedural issues. Revenue, of course, the GST revenue, the government of India and the states, all the stakeholders are not happy. Industry is equally not happy because they are not getting the credit. But one of the biggest issues before the Union Finance Minister is the revenue deficit, which is likely to be in the range of 1 lakh crore by the end of the year. That means he will fail to keep track of his or the target of fiscal deficit, 3.2% of the GDP. The another challenge is business processes, of course, which has been troubling the taxpayers in a big way. The business processes will require, expert panel has been set up, it will require a different kind of re-engineering and a corresponding reconfiguration of the GST systems. So that is to be seen how the expert panel comes up. Parallelly, the central government, the GST council has set up a separate law committee. That is another aspect. It's a big challenge. Industry has been demanding several amendments in the GST laws. How exactly all these committees, what are the options with this in front of all these committees, and what should be the roadmap before the committees, and what needs the committees must do this time? Otherwise, the economy perhaps will not give another chance, because the economy has contracted. It is bouncing back for various other regions. That is to be analyzed later by economists. So we have three domain experts who are going to look into all these aspects today. We have Mr. Sridhar, the Senior Vice President, Hindustan Coca Cola. We have Mr. Mahesh Jain, the taxation head, Dupont, and of course, our very familiar face, it will be Bimal Jain from PhD Chambers, the Indirect Tax Chairman, Committee Chairman. So let me start with Bimalji only. Bimalji, please tell us. You know, there are a lot of benefits the GST Council gave to the industry and trade, and in turn, of course, expected the manufacturers and the business entities to pass on, because in any case, all these things are supposed to be passed through. So it should be finally filtering down to the consumers. So how do you look at it? What has been your observation that industry is actually doing that? Because otherwise, the government has been threatening that anti-profiteering provisions will be invoked, right? Now, of course, some members have been already appointed also by the SEC. So what has been your, the feedback from the industry and trade and the issues which you look at today?
To answer your specific query, my answer is that, see, I must compliment Government of India and GST Council. They are very receptive. They are positive. They are making a lot many changes. Rightly said, 178 items are being taken out from 28% slab to 18% slab, and you posted a query to me how industry is doing. Industry is definitely passing on the benefit to the consumer. They have started passing on the benefit. This anti-profiteering clause should be looked into from a perspective of how religiously government and the taxpayer industry are acting to it. From industry side, I'm representing as a chairman of Indirect Tax Committee, PSG Chamber of Commerce. I can vouch industry is very religious. They are making sure that each pie benefit they are getting in terms of reduction of rate, they are passing on to the consumer. Now, government has to really believe that trade and taxpayer are the partner in nation building and development. This should not come as a threat to the taxpayer and the industry saying that if you don't do, I will do like this. Tell me, what are the parameter for anti-profiteering they have built up? What they have said, what is the parameter? They have said only two provision. If there's a tax reduction or credit available, then it must be passed on to the consumer, which we virtually doing, but there are lot many other parameters which works for the pricing, demand and supply situation, direct, indirect cost. That is going to affect your final pricing to the consumer. But you can't say that any industry, if he has not decreased the price for any XYZ region, then you will invoke anti-profiteering clause. We have to really look into legal perspective that pricing is dependent on so many other factors apart from tax rate and the credit. So anti-profiteering, of course, your point is valid. Industry is very active, positive about it, and I've seen most of them are passing on the benefit.
So Mr. Sridhar, I mean, anti-profiteering is a quicksand. I mean, of course, the government, the fact that government has not been able to come out with any kind of guidance note, that means they are treading this path very carefully. They know that it may be challenged before the High Court or it will further trouble the industry. They don't want that. They are very sensitive about it now. What has happened in the last 4 months, after that, they are a little extra careful. So, what kind of guidance note will perhaps not, be litigated by the industry? How simple it should be? Because it's a very tricky area. It's a very challenging kind of, the area where, the product specific tariff has been reduced. So, simultaneously, the prices also MRP is going down for that product. And what are the chances that, the benefits will certainly reach if the manufacturer or a large company, they decide to reduce the cost, but the distributor, the retailers, and finally in between, if there is some intermediaries, it reaches, the products reach the consumer. Actually, what happens? It may go wrong also, certain stretches.
Most of those items on 28 to 18, let us say they were all driven by the previous MRP regime. That's the way the 178 looks like.
Right.
Now, if the upstream manufacturer reduces his MRP, the changes that happen midstream, as you call it, distributors or retailers, can only happen in between. But as long as the MRP is marked down to reflect, then it's bound to reach the consumer. This is barring those exceptional situations. Second thing is, a lot of corporates are expecting that there's an overall guideline. You ask me what a guideline should be. They should first sit down and say that this should apply to a product at a national level or at a state level. The first doubt that many people seem to be having. Second, now, as Bimal correctly said, credits, input tax credits or rate of duty. Let us assume that there is a product which was taxed at X regime prior to 1/7, and after the tax regime changed, net effect of input taxes also should be taken and the tax rate should be taken. I have a small doubt here. There are some structural changes which have been brought in the income tax, in the tax regime. For example, you have done away with CST. You have done away with CST.
Right.
Now, you have done away with CST, therefore, you are getting complete credits. Is that a structural change by virtue of GST, therefore the credit should go?
Right.
Or how much of it the consumer is entitled? It's a larger academic debate.
Correct.
The third question that I can bring in is, because I am from the industry, I would like to voice what the industry feels. After 1/7, there is mayhem in the country on account of oils used. I hope you know this, I think, Mr. Shailendra, because this was debated in one of the earlier forums also.
Right.
That I'm not entitled to give C form for oils. People are before writ courts in various state high courts.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, what about those things? Who considers my costs that have happened? If I'm paying 19%, 21%, which hitherto I was getting at 2.
Right.
And people are before high courts like Orissa High Court. People are before the courts. There are matters getting reported, even including in Tax India Online.
Yes.
So how do you look at these things? And the third thing that needs to be taken apart from the structural reforms is the cost push of existing raw materials. Give a particular period for which prior to GST and post GST. And last but not the least, other direct costs which have gone up. If you sum up all this and come to a table analysis and say, this much net effect, at least you should pass on. That will be fairly reasonable.
Right.
But then to take every structural effect that has happened and saying that, this should be passed on, would be expecting too much.
Too much, absolutely. Mahesh, now, I mean, you have the hands-on experience, a lot of tough decisions you have been taking, but you are equally unlucky in terms of your goods being exempted. And you have to bear the cost of a lot of taxes on your input input materials. So how do you look at all these issues and, of course, what Mr. Sridhar suggested with respect to this?
So I will just give some background, like the industries in which we deal. One of our business is like the seed industry. And when they, in the pre-GST scenario, the goods were exempt from the output tax. In the GST, the goods was made taxable.
Right.
If 5% tax, no nominal tax. But that put the company to set up the entire SAP system and everything. And one fine day, you get a notification that your goods are again exempt.
Right.
So that's a pain. I mean, but it's good. Like the 5%, even that 5% has gone away.
Right.
However, still there are many things which need to be seen. Because the seed is a agriculture produce which is going to the farmers, and we need that the technology should come to India and the farmers should earn the profit. Even that's a mandate by the Prime Minister that the farmers' income should be doubled.
Right.
And in that sense, the input tax credit is still debatable. Mm. You bring a lot of technology from outside, pay the royalties.
Right.
Whether the GST would be available on that or not, or whether the seed itself is an agriculture produce or not, these kind of things are
all debatable. Right.
And on the top of it, though we know that the advance ruling provisions are there, but the authorities for the advance ruling, if we know that these are the government officers which might be revenue minded, and I mean the industry, we are not very comfortable that we will, if we approach them and we will get some comfortable answer or the fair answer, maybe the we would demand that that should be very impartial authority. You can really look into the issue from a larger perspective and holistically, and come out with some perfect solution, not just the keeping the revenue in the in nature.
I get the point. Yeah. Well, you know, I mean, Mahesh ji rightly raised this point, advance ruling. My worry is that advance ruling, one part of it is that good number of jurisdictions have not notified.
Yes, correct.
Number two is that even if it is notified in one jurisdiction, and if, for instance, his company is having independent business enterprises, you know, in different states, registered, having separate state GST, etc. Now, whether it's the same advance ruling given in Delhi, perhaps, or Haryana, perhaps, is it going to be acceptable in other states?
Legally not. Legally not. See, you're going to set up advance ruling from a state perspective, right? And they are going to decide in their independent capacity. So let's say Delhi advance ruling deciding a particular subject matter in your favor may not be in your favor from UP perspective. Legally, you can't put a condition that UP has to adhere. Now, if at all we are looking for good and simple tax in terms of advance ruling, my two important suggestions. If any advance ruling is being filed, first it should be electronically monitored. And instead of, once application is being made and whatever decided should be made applicable pan-India, so that no dispute persists. Second.
Okay.
Second, my suggestion is why the departmental officer is going to be advance ruling authority? Why can't we follow the SESTAT like we follow today, Custom Excise and Service Tax Appellate Tribunal? Let's have one judicial member and one technical member and let them decide. Then we can say if we are going for advance ruling, we will get certainty and clarity, which we all are looking for. So litigation can be avoided. But whatever we have seen in the past, if departmental officer going to be advance ruling authority, we have seen 90% of cases they decide against the SSC, against the taxpayer. So its problem is that seed is agriculture produce or not, taxable or not, whether I will get credit or not, and they will continue with this kind of mess. And with the second point which you have raised, if Delhi decides and that go contrary to UP, what happened in 29 states then?
Correct. Yeah.
It is going to be a big havoc for any taxpayer. That kind of good and simple we all are not looking for. In terms of good and simple, one authority, and that to be national level deciding the subject matter, and that authority would be of one judicial member, like SESTA judicial member and technical member deciding the case once for all.
Correct.
I would like to just add one more point on this. See, I think we have been discussing this for quite some time on this. There's a provision in the GST law when there is a when there is an appeal from an appellate authority, it goes to an appellate authority of the advance ruling.
Right.
And then there is a provision somewhere, I've forgotten the section, that it says that if there is a difference between two members, then the application shall deem not to have been filed under the appellate authority for advance ruling.
Right.
Under the nominee. The point is, now, if at the beginning of a journey, you bring in negativity, you bring in a set of circumspection, at least, that this may not take off, it will really not take off. Ideally speaking, we should have an amendment from the law committee suggested that there should be, if there is such a difference of opinion, you bring an impartial retired high court just to sit on a case-to-case basis. He will decide who's right.
Right.
So that it's binding. And then, as Bimal correctly said, we should have an accommodation. If the entire law has been decided by one GST council,
yes,
if one AAR decides, right, we should have that amount of magnanimity to stand up and accept that all of us will accept that advance ruling.
Correct, exactly.
So the larger issue is, if we keep on debating, when are we going to end? I fully agree that 28 collapsing to 18 in the last, from November 15th onwards, has brought down the disputes substantially.
Right.
But what about the difference between 12 and 18, which still exists? Mm. There could be still some scope between 12 and 18.
Yes, correct.
So I'm talking only on classification. Right. There could be so many things apart from classification also, which will go to an AAR.
Okay, we will touch that committee party. You wanted to add something.
No, maybe from the advanced ruling perspective, what the industry should be looking for is also the timeline, whether in a given timeline that ruling would come out. And I'm also hearing that maybe the 5 months has gone to the GST. Many states, even the advanced ruling authorities, have not been formed.
Not notified.
You're
right.
And if you're in a pan-India kind of business where you're working in all these states and we need to go state by state,
yes,
for the advance ruling.
Correct.
How to do it? Why should not be a national level kind of advance authority?
Which can, like we have, yeah, in case of income tax, even indirect tax.
That is the,
yes,
right way.
Yes.
At national level.
So maybe it will require some amendment in the law, and you know,
possible,
since the committee is revisiting.
A suggestion, right?
Yes.
Suggestion from your side,
yeah,
to law committee.
Law committee, yes.
Right away.
You amend this provision.
Yes.
Make,
yes,
it a national body.
Yes.
Rather
then
than
when you talk about all these amendments to the law committee, you just wanted to, you know, just carry this discussion away from advance ruling for a moment. How do you think that the law committee is going to start with this,
right,
one that is
passed. Right.
Why should we be looking at something afresh? All those, as we were discussing earlier, that there are so many sectoral committee reports.
Right.
I know that brief question answers came in the prominent papers and otherwise in the national press as a result of the views of the sectoral committees.
Right.
N number of suggestions have gone in. Let the government law committee now get a copy of them. Call the concerned industry, the sectoral people who represented before those committees, give them another opportunity. Barring what has happened between July to November, let's remove all those points.
Right.
The balance points are still relevant today under the structural side.
Yes.
Let them get those points across, and then let's debate those points, and instead of once again reinventing the wheel.
Absolutely.
And if you want to add fresh points,
right,
definitely it's possible.
Right.
There are so many things, right from free samples down to IUM versus ISD. If you look at the width of the issues,
right,
you can pick up at least on average, pan industry wise, at least 500 issues of law which still people have doubts. People are just waiting, and they are waiting for clarity to come.
Yeah, I agree with you. It's a huge canvas. So maybe Bimal ji will highlight it. What happened to those sectoral committees meeting? I mean, what happened? I mean, you must be having some feedback.
Feedback, you know, is only that they have submitted the report.
Right.
Earlier sectoral committee report.
Right.
What happened to those reports, we are not aware of. In the name of transparency, it would be my earnest request that sectoral committee formed, they have taken feedback and suggestion, they have created a report, that report should be made available on public domain, first of,
okay,
all. So the public must know what is this committee has done, whether,
okay,
they have done their right job or not, first of all. And second, we have to see the accountability, the report submitted to the GST Council. What GST Council has done pertaining to the report submitted.
Mm-hmm.
If these committees are being formed, they are submitting the report, but no action is being taken, then we are again following the legacy of past, which we are following for a long, long time period.
Yes.
In GST, we want to revamp and change everything. And over and over, we are forming new and new committee, mm-hmm, overlapping committee. So what happened? The earlier committee submitted the report. What you did? So let's have some clarity and certainty that what is the objective of forming that committee, what you did with the report, and what is your way forward. In case they are not being able to give right suggestion, this committee is being formed for what purpose? There must be preamble. There should not be a case, I want to satisfy one particular group, let's form the committee.
Mm.
We were knowing that GST and network is not working. This committee was formed very recently under chairmanship of GST and chairman.
Right.
We were knowing everything. Now we definitely want to know what this committee has really got, all the input, what suggestion they are giving to the government of India. And let's put on public domain for public debate. And then finalize, scrutinize all the final point for GST Council. And let GST Council take a call, okay, out of 10 suggestions, 5 accepted and 5 is not acceptable for so and so region. That will give more clarity to all of us together.
Do you think so? I mean, is it? I mean, this will like swing the DuPont seeds for more transparency. You know,
actually, if you go beyond many things, I think we should be seeing from the sectoral committee reports is that you just take this latest CST. I agree with what Bimal says. We are fighting between July to November to implement GST. I mean, I'm going back to this petroleum controversy. There is a West Bengal circular which is beneficial.
Yes.
And in West Bengal, people are doing it beneficially for the purpose of buying
petrol.
Absolutely. High-speed diesel. Mainly in industries for the purpose of production because power is not freely available in India. Why go beating around the bush?
Correct.
Now, the interpretation a few states have taken, I don't want to name the states, they are saying that in the Taxation Laws Amendment Act in 2017, when this was amended, the definition of goods have been changed. It has been brought down only to the residual number of goods. So unless you are a dealer of those goods, you are not entitled to use the forms.
Now,
you have collapsed the whole sense of trust that was left for. So now, does it mean that somebody takes a cost push? I'm just answering your previous question.
Right.
So my cost of HSD has gone up by, let's say, few lakhs per month. Somebody who's asked to justify to the anti-profiteering committee will say, sorry, sir, please mark this as a negative. Because it has gone up because there's a lack of policy in this direction. X number of states are allowing me to do so. Y number of states are not allowing me to do so. Where do I get? I have got factories everywhere. Do I push diesel from factory
one
to factory?
Correct. Absolutely.
No, this is, in my opinion, the right example for transparency. Because there's no point in just saying things theoretically. If the government wants to know why this is a problem.
Damn.
And we have not even begun GST. We are allowing people to go to once again, the whole objective of what the Prime Minister desired was less litigation. Good and
Correct.
Simple tax.
Absolutely.
Now, within 5 months, people are before the high courts. Then what have we achieved? What we are achieving for the future?
For anti-profiteering, one more suggestion coming to my mind, why can't government come out with a guidance note? What are the parameters for the anti-profiteering?
Yes.
Apart from tax rate reduction and credit made available, which was not available earlier. Like Mr. Sridhar has rightly pinpointed number of things and even I...
Or maybe they should, you know, while tailoring this kind of guidance note, they should seek this kind of inputs from the industry.
Yes.
And then they should come out with, or they should have a draft guidance note, give 1 month time to industry, revise it and then notify.
Yes. And this guidance note will work out in a right perspective. You're not giving threat to the trade.
Right.
At the same time, you're also controlling and checking. You're not having no paper ready, appointing authority. He may decide whatever he thinks best. To the best of his knowledge, are you really willing to leave everything to a person? Whereas we are saying anti-profiteering is like a sword. It can fall either way. So we have to see the relevance of this anti-profiteering and we have to see pricing is dependent on so many other factors. Come out with a guidance note. There are so many institutions, ICAI, ICSI, ICMA. Why can't you take their help and prepare? And sectoral wise, you can, in case you feel like, no, this is not possible, sectoral wise, at least you can analyze the data. You have data that this particular sector has got this many indirect taxes. These were leviable pre-GST. Now this is the impact. This was the credit not available, now available. In terms of broad parameter, this is the benefit coming out. Let's work out CST and other component, pricing other component, give some percentage cushion, 2%, 3%, and then work out minimum this much must go to the consumer, sectoral wise. That kind of guidance note paper must be ready, like we follow accounting standard for a particular sector. Right. Why can't we have guidance? And you cannot apply anti-profiteering uniformly, standardly applicable to all sectors.
All the sectors, absolutely.
It can't be possible.
I agree with you. Yeah. So maybe, this input will go to the government.
Yeah.
I think, the Directorate of Safeguard, which is working on this, probably they will take note of it. And I'm sure they are about to come, by Christmas perhaps. Or it's really good. They would like to make it a New Year gift to us. So apart from that, of course, there are various other legal issues which we could touch. But more than that, either transitional side, not the fact that GST 2.3 is gone, the credit part, which is apparently bothering the industry. And how this is going to be worked out, because now this 2.3 is gone. Mr. Sridhar, you will have some opinion up to March.
Yeah,
what should be done?
First, let's have a direction of what we want to do up to March and then beyond March. Up to March, I mean, our earnest desire is that, and the humble plea to the government is that 3B should be equivalent to my previous central excise regime credit. I have an invoice, I'm entitled to credit.
Right.
Let GSTR 1 and 3B settle down beyond.
Right.
Whatever we need to file for GSTR 1 up to December 31st, let them file. Let the GSTR 2 committee report, which is supposed to come out, let it come out. Let us all work together and file parallel runs of GSTR 2 and compare it with big and small suppliers. And after April, let them put the system correctly in place and let's look at a comparison beyond April. If you as a from the press, if you are really looking at the fact that is anybody ready for a prior period comparison for July to March, if somebody were to say he's ready, then I would leave it to his choice. But if you ask the industry and the trade, forget the industry. Industry will at least measure up something out of 175. But what about the traders who are between 2 crores to 10 crores? They are not small scale.
They are not.
You are no more in that because you're beyond the limit. 2 to 10, must he not justify the credit? Is he prepared? I don't think so. We are prepared up to March. So the only thing would be up to March, no verification based on 3B and GSTR 1. You allow the credits. Get the system ready for GSTR 2 by 1st April. Commence invoice to invoice after 1st April. This is our request.
Right, Mahesh, you would like to add something?
No, I would say on the input tax credit, like we talk about the ease of doing business, and again, there are certain rules. This is allowed, this is not allowed, this is business input, this is not. I would say everything is a business input. I mean, why we can't make our life simple that anything which is going to the business is creditable.
Right.
And otherwise, it's a cascading impact again.
What is the change in the earlier system
and this system?
I mean, why can't we?
And what is the amount we are talking about? I mean, how much revenue loss government will have if they make the life easier for everyone? Any input to the business is an input and it's allowed. If you can compare with the other countries, taxation law, even our neighboring countries, there is no distinguish between the end use of input tax credit. I mean, anything which is going to the business is creditable. And believe me, maybe most of the tax disputes arises on this only.
Right.
The auditor will come and they will find out that you have claimed something which is not allowable to you. You will say, no, it's my business purpose, it's allowable to me. And then the matters goes for the 15 years up till the Supreme Court decide this.
But one thing, sir, actually this is a very important point. You know, even the exclusions under 17, really if you look at it, one critical item is relevant for the Government of India. 2011 amendment in the Senate credit rules. I'm going back to this industrial canteens and outdoor canteen.
Yes.
All tribunals, you have lost the dispute. Let us accept it with magnanimity. How many more times we'll keep fighting? Just because you're capable of legislating, does it mean that there should be no credit? Did not the tribunals decide that welfare activity of a worker is in the course of business?
So recently, how many times
we will re-establish this truth? Yeah. Just because you are writing a new law, does it mean that you can write a law which is not in line with what? Does it mean all those people, wise people who sat in the tribunals, who n number of hours they have spent looking at the law, looking at what the environment should be and how to interpret the law, were all those efforts not waste, absolute waste? Or why should we go back? The current 17 talks about outdoor canteen. I'm not allowed. Why we are once again?
Mr. Sridhar, another suggestion to the law committee. They said input and input services used in the course of furtherance of business credit is available, but with so much of subjectivity and with past
experience.
Let's have clarity whether you really want to pass on or not. If any activity relating to my business and you are willing to give me a credit, don't put condition on rider. Otherwise, looks like you are again putting condition not to give me the credit.
Absolutely.
Right.
Don't do that. Recently, I fought a case only on outdoor catering after 1st April 2011, which they put up condition. Tribunal are allowing. They are saying credit is available, even though they have made the change. But litigation has to travel. It has cost for both taxpayer and tax department.
Right. So it's time now that we should leave the canteen behind.
We want it.
Isn't it? but the most important point is, I personally feel that, you know, looking at the health of the exchequer, the commitment of a political dispensation in terms of centrally sponsored welfare scheme for the poor, etc., which may be linked to boats, etc., etc. But, you know, looking at underprivileged, little marginalized, sections in the society, I understand that worldwide the GST, every economy implements and puts riders, which we are talking about in terms of credit. And as rightly suggested, that every legitimate business expenditure should be available for credit. So that is an idealistic situation, you know, but, you know, lots of blockages, either for the capital goods or, you know, even for the raw materials or services, you know, all these things are linked to, you know, the health of the exchequer. So probably because of that, and gradually the government will certainly do that. I'm pretty sure, you know, that they will unblock, you know, some of the credit which has been blocked today. One good suggestion which Mahesh Ji apparently said, that, you know, if the government takes a view that, you know, out of this 100 rupees expenditure for the business, maybe government will make it very clear. The law itself will say that we will allow you credit for 90 rupees.
Yeah.
Finished.
That's next.
You don't get into the dispute of whether it is capital goods, whether it is certain services, or whether it is, you know, the hotel accommodation for my executives. So it will not be allowed, you know, so many other limitations, or maybe outdoor catering, or etc.
That is the best alternative you're suggesting.
You know, I mean, it's just simple.
Yes.
90
yes.
rupees gone. I have yes. spent 100 rupees on raw material, or, you know,
the, and can we cross
the input
verify?
Services or whatever.
It can be cross-verified, direct taxes versus indirect taxes.
Absolutely, it's close.
Yes.
I mean, do you think this kind of feasibility
yeah,
or...
Ideally, if you look at it, whether that is good, whether then somebody in the sectors, each sector has got, somebody will say, fair point for 90 for you is not a fair point for 90 for somebody else. Yeah. That it could become subjective. But somewhere there could be some... Our only point is there's no point in having a liberal 16 and a restricting 17. Mm-hmm. If you see the CGST law,
right.
Both exist side by side.
It can other way around, actual or 90%, whichever age, higher. Right. So at least what happened to that, you wanted that government is looking their own tax collection. So they can allow as per actual or 90%, and later on they can liberalize depending on their collection happening. And this is cross-verifiable, direct taxes versus indirect taxes, and government is looking for merging both together,
yes.
way forward.
Right.
So my direct taxes PL side, debit side is verifiable from the income tax side. Cross verify, give me the credit which I'm looking for. Don't put condition of like, you know, if this is done for construction of a commercial building, you will not get credit. Without building, I can't run my show. You're not giving credit. Such kind of subjectivity giving a hint that we are not in seamless flow of credit.
And if you are not treating me to some good restaurant, you know, you will not get business. It's very clear.
Yes,
you are not getting credit for that.
Of course, none.
You know, the
none.
Business development, you know, it's very important, you know,
yes.
that you receive.
No, I can give another example, very, you know, relevant example, the capital goods. If suppose you buy any capital goods and you are using those capital goods for exempted as well as
taxable
yeah. goods. What the law says.
The formula.
The formula says. The formula says you take the full credit and whenever you use for the non-taxable, you reverse that credit with 18% interest.
Yes.
How this 18% interest come to the picture?
And where this formula came from? It was not there before. Earlier regime, there was a credit to be reversed.
The whole philosophy is perhaps that because
yeah.
they are keen to merge every rate in 18.
Only if it is exclusively used in exempted goods.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Rule 6-4.
Yeah. Rule 6-4, yeah. yes. Rule 6-4.
Even in the export oriented unit, the DTA, they allow some use of those kind of plant and machinery for say 50% to the domestic use. Even the similarly in GST, why such kind of provisions are not there?
How can you discern in capital goods?
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. You know, regarding the conversion point, you know, as a converter for export goods
yeah.
and domestic, what is the position in fact?
Even in the, like even the foreign trade policies, even I think today is the review for the midterm review. And
tomorrow
the,
it's
yeah,
coming.
Tomorrow
yeah.
is coming and
right.
I think the government must be reviewing. The GST law is not marrying with the FTP policies which is running currently, and there are multiple issues in that.
No, I have overheard that they are
yeah.
trying to align it. They are giving more relaxation to MEIS and SEIS, which I have heard it. And you have seen interim benefit they have given MEIS, SEIS can be used for
IGST
also. So government is really trying
very
to...
Very keen to marry.
Yeah.
not interested to go.
Tomorrow you may heard.
That
yeah.
way, yes.
Yeah, tomorrow
is coming.
To,
yes.
Tomorrow you are going to hear some of the good news from foreign trade policy.
Oh, that's yes. very good.
It is my...
If it happens, or
yeah.
even for the export-oriented units, whether the... why the goods input should not be tax free. similar to the special economic zone, right. And why the all the input tax should be paid and we should file a refund and wait for a refund. We can. Even
but
some of the things.
You know, for all those units which are engaged in export, perhaps the treatment should be uniform.
Yes, correct. You know? Correct.
I mean, there is no need to...
Ultimately, when we want to promote export, we have to make sure that it is uniform at par for all the...
And there should not be any working capital blockage.
Yes, correct.
That is first pay the taxes and then claim for a refund. You can create a mechanism, and the earlier mechanism was there in the EOU setup where you can buy without... I mean, you issue some forms and you can buy the goods without central excise duty. Why can't this similar provisions?
But here also, even if you look, one thing that I was expecting in the question is if this law committee is going to look at these issues, what is the time frame that we are looking at? Is the amendment before the finance bill 18-19 hits the parliament, is it possible? In that view, it's not possible because this is January 31st and therefore we will not be able to get anything.
This amendment. These amendments have to be a part of the finance bill. Yeah.
If it is going to be beyond that,
yes.
Whether the states will take it up in their relevant state budgets for the SGST
revisions,
is it possible? Because the structural issues, even if you take top 20 issues of each sector, one classic issue is there's so much of lack of clarity in the markets about this ISD versus IUM interoffice. There was supposed to be some exemption for specified class of services. Right. Those notifications have not come.
Right.
Under which conditions do I use ISD? Because no more there is a factory as a principle. So there is no question of an input coming in and going out like we had in the olden days. Mm-hmm. So then if it's for the purpose of business, what is wrong if it is either an ISD or an IU? Because it doesn't make a difference as long as one state will reverse the credit and other state will take the credit. Mm-hmm. If you start from this and go, there are about minimum 100 issues, minimum top rate issues for all the industries put together. Looking at the physical possibility and the commercial feasibility of it hitting this 2018 budget, the time available is very little.
Very little, yeah. That's true. Correct.
So at least maybe from an industry perspective is if we can't do all the 100, this is what I thought I should place, that take top 5 for each of the sectoral committee reports, which have not been answered.
Right.
Or top 2 if time is not available. At least the 2 let it get into the finance bills and the finance bills of the respective states.
Right. Absolutely, yes.
And that the balance can be taken up over a period of time.
Over a period of time, yeah. So on this positive note, and some sort of roadmap which our distinguished panelists have suggested to the Indian Finance Minister that what he should be doing. I'm pretty sure he must have made up his mind what he's going to do. And we are looking forward to see a lot of amendments in the GST laws because it has to be a part of the money bill. Otherwise, there would be a separate round of the political dishum in days to come. And that will delay and that will further damage the GST overall architecture. And of course, the credit side, as rightly suggested, that the fact that the GST are 2 and 3 and it's being reviewed, it has been put in a state of suspension. So ideally, the credit should be, probably the revenue authority should look at pre-1st July era and match it and see that if there is some kind of, serious aberration, then perhaps, certain penal provisions or maybe the disallowance could be made. Looking at other aspect, as rightly suggested, for anti-profiteering, the guidance notes should come out very fast because that is becoming a serious issue even for the government and for the industry because the industry is very worried, uncertain. There have been a little threatening tone from here and there, and that is scary for the people who are specialized in doing business. And they just expect that the GST original design should not be damaged in a big way. And if at all it has to be overhauled, then it should be done in one go rather than in a piecemeal fashion, because that creates a serious issue for the GST network and also for the industry and trade, which has to ultimately comply with all those changes. Mm-hmm. So let's look forward to some of the positive changes and all the reports of the 4 different expert panel reports, which are already looking into all these issues, should be made public so that industry and trade could also contribute to the overall inputs which can go either as a part of the finance bill or as a part of a report to be presented on after 5th January meeting of the GST Council. So let's look forward to some positive changes and compliment the government for taking bold decisions for putting a stop, a halt, and asking the experts that look into it fresh, and we will sort of reignite and reboot the whole thing. So the rebooting should be proper, so that the reboot does not require another set of a reboot.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you for watching TIOL TUBE, and let me thank all my guests.
Thank you.